Good evening, friends. I welcome all of you for the 8th webinar of Corporate Professional during this COVID lockdown. Today's topic is Leaning Out of Group, Consolidation and Simplification of Group Structure, a pertinent consideration in post-COVID era. Friends, I'm very happy to share that all our program which we have organized got overwhelming response from our fellow professionals and the industry. In each program, we got a registration of more than 700 to 1500, and the attendance also was very good. And in the interesting part is in question answer session, we were receiving more than 72 up to 250 questions, which we are trying to give answers. Today's program is also very pertinent because what is happening when we are working in the organization and in the normal life, we always are in a running position. We run and we think everything is chalta hai. But during the COVID era, we had a pause. We are thinking, we are rethinking, and we are planning. The planning is how to reduce cost, how to increase efficiency, and how to keep everything simplified. So this point comes under the restructuring point, that why we have formed so many companies. What is the purpose of forming these companies and increasing cost and creating a confusion? So in this same respect, we are organizing today's program, and we have invited two learned speakers, those who will share their experience. First, Preeti Malhotra, she is the chairman of Smart Bharat Group, and she is a past president of Institute of Company Secretary and first lady president. She has an experience of more than 30 years in the industry in various capacity, in hospitality, in mobile, and in the electronic, and the various new things. So Preeti will share her experience about their group, that what are the issues relating to having multiple companies. Preeti is representing a very old group of India, and she has seen, and that group has seen each and everything. That why they have formed various companies, because of joint venture, because of various different type of business and multiple things. So I welcome Preeti. And then we have a second speaker, Mr. Aran Malu. He is a professionally chartered accountant, throughout a scholar who got a 4th rank in Rajasthan University in graduation and 15th rank in chartered accountancy. He has 35 years experience, 10 years in practice, and 25 years in as a corporate CFO of very various companies. Mr. Malu is from Surya Roshni Group. It is also one of the oldest group, and multiple business they are doing, multiple structure they have. So his experience and his knowledge will give us a new dimension, that why we are forming companies and what is the reason. So the program structure will be like this. First, Preeti Malhotra will speak, and then Mr. Malu will speak, and they will share their experience. And then I will tell you why people are forming various companies and what is the irrelevancy today. Then Mr. Manoj will tell you how to consolidate this thing, what are the issues you will face, and how to solve this. And then we will have a question answer session. Anybody who has any question, they can send it to us. We will keep it ready and we'll ask after the presentation. So thank you very much, friends. Now I will request Preeti Malhotra to say about her experience on the consolidation. Over to Preeti.
Thank you, Mr. Pavan Vijay, and also Mr. Malu, Mr. Manoj, and all participants. Many thanks, Pavan, for asking me to speak on this subject. I think it's a great topic of immense importance and relevance, especially in today's times. Structuring of businesses and companies is critical not only for simplification, but for appropriate structuring, which can have a big impact on your business performance. In fact, too many entities to manage take too much management time and focus on compliance rather than the efficient management of businesses, which is the requirement. All corporate houses, I think, today end up having large corporate structures, sometimes spread over different countries, since corporate structuring becomes extremely important during transactions. You know, be it joint ventures, be it mergers and acquisitions, partnerships, prior to IPOs, buyouts, exits, especially when you want to exit a business, exit a joint venture. You know, since simplification could also be a pre-step of a sale of part of the group to make it attractive for buyers. Or it could also just be just succession planning. I mean, if an industrialist wants to distribute assets between, you know, the sons and daughters, sometimes simplification becomes important. Also, value, something which people miss out is the value may also be trapped deep within the corporate structure and potentially lead to even dividend blocks. Business owners may want to eliminate companies not only for tax efficiency, but also to maximize returns to shareholders. And for all shareholders, all stakeholders, there could be historic negative reserves, which could also prevent future dividend distribution. So normally in groups, you have a large number of JVs for different businesses over a period of time. Like even in the case of our group, we had multiple joint ventures with different global entities over a period of time. And with each joint venture, you end up with a new SPVs, other subset of companies, subsidiaries for different partners, different products, different business lines. And over a period of time, you exit certain partnerships, enter into new ones. And as a result, you create complex structures which are not relevant for your current requirements. And since the purpose for which they were formed may become infructuous, all these companies, really turn into cost centers and take unnecessary management time. So revaluation of structures becomes very important when you have to attract investment and funds into groups. Investors definitely prefer cleaner, transparent, accountable structures. The due diligence becomes easier. It also becomes easier to follow the corporate governance norms. Consolidation of accounts becomes easier. Also, there are lesser related party transactions. The management can focus on business issues rather than companies, and as a result, have lesser regulatory lapses too. And as I mentioned, having too many companies can become very expensive, and especially so because of the changing financial reporting and regulatory landscape. On the other side, the regulators today are also focusing on ease of business, and they're seeing how to reduce timelines for compliance, mergers, dissolution, etc. In fact, I was a member of the Company Law Committee of the Ministry of Corporate Affairs, and we decriminalized various offences, and one of the reasons was really to ensure that national company law tribunals and other tribunals gets more time to focus on fast-tracking mergers and other important issues rather than dealing with mundane matters. Also, groups have a lot of investment companies. One has to be also careful that in case these companies acquire an NBFC or a systematically important CIC status, again, necessary approvals and compliance have to be put in place. So again, having too many investment holding companies may not be a very good idea. The regulators today are also focusing, as I mentioned to you, on ease of doing business. And, coming to the process, when you want to condense the structure, you have to look at different issues from the perspective of tax, both direct, indirect, regulatory issues, RBI issues, FEMA issues, valuation issues. Then there are other implications, including stamp duties in case of companies which may have properties held by the company and so forth. And again, for restructuring of listed entities, there are other legal and compliance issues which need to be looked into. It is therefore very important to spend time to see how one can condense group structures, make it more productive and simplified. Implementing it is definitely has its own set of challenges, but I think it is achievable over a long period of time. It is achievable over a time period. Of course, a lot of challenges, in the sense, a lot of planning, due diligence needs to, you have to go into a lot of planning, due diligence to ensure that there is appropriate elimination of companies which are tax efficient. You have the necessary approvals from the bankers, shareholders, and all of that. There are various modes of simplification, including striking off of companies, mergers, demergers, voluntary winding up. I'm happy that Corporate Professionals has kept a special webinar on this subject, and I'm sure that the participants will find these technical sessions very useful. I'll be here for any questions that you may ask, and I hand over back to Pavan, Mr. Pavan Vijay. Thank you.
Thank you, Preeti. Thank you very much for giving your experience and your insight of this particular issue. No doubt, Modi Group is one of the oldest group of India. Okay, and you have mentioned the all types of experience you have seen, and now these things which were running, now you have to think and you have to reduce and make it simplified. So the key word which you have mentioned, that efficient and simplified structure, is the requirement of today. Thank you, Preeti, for giving your insight. Now I'll request Mr. R.N. Malu. He is also working in a very old group. Simultaneously, he has worked in Rajasthan RSW group also, which is also one of the oldest group, and they have a multiple business, multiple things. So his experience will increase the knowledge of every participant and all of us. Over to Mr. Malu, please.
Thank you, Bhavanji. I would first of all like to congratulate corporate professionals for organizing this webinar and enlightening all of us in the present timing of COVID-19. See how I see COVID-19. If I see COVID-19, so and what we have to think, what we have to visualize is very important. I see C is relating to the cost. What is our cost of materials? What is cost of our processes, whether backward process or forward process? We have to take care of about all these costs in this scenario. Why I am talking all this is to see that how we have to formulate our strategy. O stands for overheads. We have to reduce our overheads. We have not only to reduce, rationalize the overheads, which consist of starting from personal interest, manufacturing overheads, administrative overheads, marketing overheads. We have to think for work from home. Within that, we have to also see for the compliances. We here stands, according to me, is the value creation, is the vision. Value creation comes from the vision. And for that, it is very important in which corporate structure we are. What is the need of this structure? I here stands for information technology. We have to work with information technology. D stands for demand. Whatever activities, whatever services we are giving in our organization, we have to review those things and must see that from demand scenario point of view, whether we need these much of outlets, these much of companies and all these things or not. And 1 to 9 stands for anything which we have to prioritize. So how, this is the way, my way of analyzing this COVID-19. See, when we think of here, the most relevant thing is the vision and the how we have to run our organizations. Whether we have to own 100 companies, whether it is on promoter side or whether it is on the delivery side. We may have different companies. We may have different companies for different businesses. We have to also think that whether these businesses are survival or not. If these businesses are not survival in COVID-19 scenario, it is better that we consolidate all these businesses and we create a strength by consolidation. While doing the consolidation, we have to analyze that what sort of a structure we want, whether we want to have 3 companies or 5 companies. For this, we have to have the timelines into consideration, various modes of consolidation. The expert of the subject, Manoj, Preeti and Bhavanji, will definitely highlight on this subject. But my area is that how many companies I really need it, whether I want an NBFC company in my group or do not want it, whether I want an NBFC company for holding of the shares or for loans advances, that is also very important for me. When I decide about these things, what I do is we have to have consultants along with us. There are different areas involved, that is in the income tax, we have to see whether we are having carry forward made, whether we are having depreciation, exemptions, we have to arrange for NOCs, which means we have to see that whether there are any cases involved, and there should not be any difficulty in that. We have to obtain the ROC permission, official liquidator's permission. All these things we have to take care of. While going to NCLT, we may engage the same consultant who are advising us in the company law, or we may adopt for another consultant. The NCLT, before that, we have to also see that in how many states the consultation is involved. If there are in two states, then we have to see that is it better to consolidate those companies, to transfer the registered office of those companies in one state. And then we have to think on this part. We have to ensure for NOC for this EB. Stamp duty is also very important. Stamp duty here involved is from the share capital point of view. It is also applicable on the value of the involved assets, involved properties. In few of the states, Manoj will tell you in detail that whether there is a stamp duty, what are the different stamp duty rates, and definitely a planning is involved, a close interaction, a foresightness is required with your consultants. From finance side, we have to take care of about the accounting standards. There are different things which gives you various opportunities in the consolidated entities or the demerged entities. There are GST law. GST law is comparatively very simple. GST law simply tells you that in case of an ongoing concern, there is no GST. They provide you carry forward of input tax credit accumulation to another entity. So comparatively, the GST law is simple. While deciding this consolidation, we have to also take care of all the HR related issues. This is very practical part that you might be having different business heads. What will be their designations? How you will be handling them? Who will be the senior to whom? Who will be there in your board of directors? Who will not be the board of directors? That is also very important. We have to also see about the IT related issues. Which are the platforms? Whether they will really be able to reconcile or not? All these things we have to take care of. We have to plan that how the merger of the income tax returns is going to happen. What are the benefits we are going out of that? See, these are the things I have seen that we have done lot of mergers, lot of acquisitions, and demergers also. We have been continuously interacting with our investors, and we see that there is to be a purpose. There is to be a purpose, and if that purpose is fulfilled, it gives definitely a value. So we have to take care of all these things, and in these timings, our strength is the larger is the size of the organization, better it is to face this COVID-19 situation. When we go to our banks, when we go out to our rating agencies, we also get upgradations, and the upgradations helps you in getting right type of finances, maybe a commercial paper or maybe external corporate borrowings or maybe tradable papers. It gives you, it increases your rating also sometimes. So we have to see all these part. But one thing I will definitely advise, that any inefficient part, if we are having in organization, we should not do a mistake of consolidating the same. Consolidation may be an easier task, but demerger later on may be a difficult task. So we have to take care of all these things. This is my practical version of these things. I think Manoj will give us a view out how it is to be done, and it will be really, really beneficial to all of us. Thanks again to Pavanji, Preetiji and Manoj. Thank you.
Thank you, Maluji. Thank you very much for giving insight. Now, no doubt, you have given a new dimension of COVID definition. C mean cost, O mean overhead. You have to reduce this. And then you have to create value creation, that is V. With the help of information technology, we can be information technology that can create efficiency And ultimately, all these things can create D, that is demand. Demand means more profit. So thank you very much for giving a new definition, a positive definition of COVID. Now, I will take up this point that why this leaning out of group is important and what is the reason and why we are doing. So the point is, first point comes, why multiple companies under one umbrella, it was there, and how this is moving. Can you change the slides? So the point is, why multiple companies? So the multiple companies, the reason is, the first is, they have formed the company, Preeti and Mr. Malu has told. Now there was so many companies they have formed because of their different business. So they want SPV. Then they have a different foreign partner, Indian partner. They require joint venture, and the joint venture requires subsidiary. So you are creating multiple companies. So I'm just explaining why we have created more companies in any group. Then fee facilitated intercorporate loan advance related party transaction. We require more companies. Then regulatory reason, license raj is there. Then you can't do big business. You have to do a small business. So you have a multiple companies. Then land ceiling act. You can't have land in one company because various state has a land ceiling. So you are forming various company to do the business and doing this. Then there was a legal compulsion. The legal compulsion was that you have to form a company, like for example, stockbroking. Stockbroking and commodity cannot be in a one company, and that's why you have to form, despite of same promoter, two companies. Then sometimes the promoter they want to do business, but they don't want to show their identity. That's why the group identity they were hiding and they were forming company. Separate entities to get benefit provided by state government, because each state has different benefit. So you are forming different companies in different state. So multiple companies you have created. Then you avoid applicability of various labor law, because as per labor law, you should have 20% and 10%. So people are avoiding labor law and forming various small companies. Then form for a specific purpose, like you have a IPR, so you want to have a separate company, property for separate company. Sometime you want to avoid the litigation, that's why you are forming a various company to hold the asset. So if there's any problem, that company can take care. Then tax saving reason. Previously the tax was, if you have a one company, you have a more tax, than was a less turnover, less tax, less profit, less tax. So that's why people were segregating various turnover and tax related issue to take advantage. Then low cost of incorporation was the one of the main reason, that 4,000 rupees you can form a company, and the compliance was also not very strong that time. So nobody was bothering about how, if you have formed a company and you are not filing any document, so there was no problem that time. And then various transfer of business, merger, split, power of attorney, and various other aspects was there. But ultimately the reason was that cost of incorporation was less, and then compliance cost was very less, because nobody was asking you whether you have complied or not. But now the situation has changed. So the question comes that why leaning out? So the leaning out is taking place because of various reasons. First is, they reduce multiple administrative responsibility, legal and regulatory compliances. Now, if you have a structure which is reducing, then the multiple administrative responsibility and compliance will reduce. Then you can reduce cross-holding amongst the companies, simplified and controlled structure for easy regulatory disclosure, because now beneficially ownership concept has come. So you have to give the clear cut that who owns the company. So you can't hide the identity. That's why the cross-holding and other things, which was the reason that people were not showing their identity, that is not available today. Then come to the simplify and rationalize of group structure. Everybody wants that simplification and rationalization of group create more benefit than any other thing. Then in some company there is a profit, some company there is a loss, so you can take advantage of that simplified process also. And tax payment is same, there is no advantage of small entities have a less tax. And then simplify incorporation is also one of the reasons people previously forming a company and heave it and thinking, because incorporation was taking 40 days, 50 days. And then so many professionals were making a shell company, keeping in mind that anybody can require this company. And for one business, one transaction, people were using company and they were thinking, okay, we will use it later on. Then the people are taking advantage of asset and net worth in different entity. It is blocked, so you can merge all these things. And then various company which you have formed, it has no operational business, so you can close these company. And then concept of core and non-core has also come, and because of your illiquid asset is lying there, you can use it for your core business. Then you can take advantage of your asset and net worth in one entity and becoming a big. Previously the concept was multiple layer, multiple group, tax planning, other things. Now the time has come when people are talking about the big company, big business and big organization. So that's why you require consolidation. Then minimize administrative managerial cost. That is another aspect, because cost is more and people are nowadays after the COVID realize that we have to reduce cost, unnecessary cost has to go down. Then the cost of non-compliance is very heavy. Previously you formed a company and then you forget, there was no question. Today you form a company and you are not complying, then government can strike off these name and then put the penalty on directors that they cannot become director in another company. So that is another point. So people are thinking that why we are holding these companies. In India, we had a 17 lakh companies. Out of this, government has strike off 6 lakh companies and the various companies are in the process. So today also 10 lakh companies and various companies is not filing forms return. That's why the government has taken action and they are identifying that which company is not filing and which company is formed just for the sake, and they are taking action. Then legal structure is also now simplified. You can form the broken company in the commodity company in the same company, same time government is allowed various companies. Then pursuant to the government ministry's notification that you cannot have more than 2 layer of subsidiary companies, and that's why people are not, the corporates are not in a position to do this, because if you create a web of companies, it is not identified as a good structure. Every government organization and the media is giving a negative view to these companies that they have formed a company and you are not able to identify. Then the transparency and governance is also taking a new dimension, and everybody is asking in the governance simplified process. Various PE fund is coming and they are investing and they are asking your structure should be neat and clean. You should not have different type of structure which can create problem. So all these things which have created in the market is giving reason that why we should have companies, why we should have multiple companies, what is the purpose of having this, why we can't merge this. So the time has come, everybody is thinking, let's consolidate, let's make more structured organization, more simplified organization. And the way Mr. Malu has mentioned the definition of COVID, so the three things are important. You should have transparent organization. Transparency comes when you have a simplified system, and then simplified system gives more efficiency and more business and more things. So I think these things can help you and these things can give you. But the question is how to do it, because there are so many issues, tax issue, stamp issue, accounting issue, and then issue is a government issue. If you have a listed company, then SEBI approval, stock exchange approval, income tax approval, and various other legal process. So all these things, how to do this, I request Manoj Kumar. He is a partner in a corporate professional. Manoj is our Chalta Firta Ramaiya, and he is one of the very intelligent person who handles the entire gamut of M&A, and Preeti and Mr. Malu has worked with Manoj. They can realize that Manoj is expertise in restructuring business, and he handle the tax aspects, the stamp duty aspects, listing aspects, company law aspects, and the various other regulatory aspects. So he will tell us how to do leaning out of group. Over to Manoj to tell about your process, the how the company can do.
Thank you very much, sir. Good evening, everyone. Good evening, Mr. Malu, Preeti ma'am. So as we are discussing about the leaning out, and Mr. Malu has given management, similarly Preeti ma'am has also given detailed perspective of any group, any big corporate house, how they, why they form so many period of time, and when the question of consolidation or reducing the number comes, what are the issues they face, and what are the major precautions they need to take. So here I would like to discuss what are the regulatory processes are there, and what are the basic major challenges are there, and then how to handle them. And then later on we can have a question answer session where I would like, or we would collectively like the queries. Many of the leaning out. Leaning out means in case of workout, let's say we are talking about a person's body, when there is extra fat, we need to burn those fat by a systematic manner. And that the same things goes about when a group becomes fat, bigger, and there are certain entities which are redundant, or they are consuming the resources which are otherwise available, may be available for better use, then it is a time to consider leaning out. And as we all know that the COVID is a time when we all are thinking about reducing cost and creating efficiency in the organization. So this is the right time to consider leaning out. And yes, there will be challenges in each of such restructuring consolidation, but if we plan properly, we can get good value from leaning out of any corporate group. So if we what to do? So first step would be to determine what are the redundant entities or extra entities in a group. Then what method can we use to reduce them, whether to strike off those companies. Striking off is a simpler process through companies closed and entities closed. So whether it is applicable, it can be done, or whether voluntarily liquidate the company, or go for merger or consolidation within a group, multiple companies within the group. So then this will be the second thought. Then what is the benefit? So we have to see simplification of the group structure. Then there may be multiple layers of company or cross holdings among the companies. So how to reduce that? Then whether there are assets in any of the company which are not functional or which are not giving real value, real use of those assets, then how to unlock those value. Then this is the whole process of leaning out. So broadly, if you talk about closure of a company, can be by three methods. One is simplified one. First, the striking off. The second one is the voluntary liquidation, and third one is the amalgamation of more than one companies. So as I told, the striking off is a simpler method, but it can be applied not in all cases. It can be applied when there is no business in a company, or if a company was formed for a specific business purpose and that purpose is gone, then it is better to get the company striked off. However, the condition is there should not be any asset or liability left in the company. So then only we can apply under Section 248 of the Companies Act to the register of the company, and the register of the company will then, after a certain notice period, will close the company. But there are certain restrictions applicable to any strike off. Also, many type of companies are not eligible for striking off, like listed companies are not eligible. Then Section 8 companies are not eligible even if there is no business. Then even after striking off of the company, the liability of directors, officers, and the members of the company remain as the company goes. But if some demand comes at a later date, it has to be paid by the officers of the company. Another alternative is the voluntary liquidation. Earlier, voluntary liquidation was under the Companies Act, but now it is shifted to the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code. So under that, this is also a process which is a long-drawn process. We have to appoint a liquidation professional, which is insolvency resolution professional, who will take over the management of the company and liquidate the assets and then distribute the assets to the stakeholders. So the precondition is the company should be solvent. It should be able to pay all the debts first by liquidating all the assets in the company, and there is no objection from shareholders and creditors. Then here the challenges are the distribution of money or assets to the extent of accumulated profits are considered as deemed dividend, and hence it is not a tax efficient process. The other challenge is the timeline is very high. It may take 6 to 12 months. Sometimes if the immovable properties are there, their liquidation may take longer, and sometimes it is not beneficial to liquidate, like in present time when the assets value are not easy to determine, realize, then it is not possible to liquidate. Then there may be some carry forward losses or some the fee paid to on authorized capital, or there are some IPRs which all goes in the process of voluntary liquidation. So generally this process is also not suitable in all cases. Then the third one is the mergers or amalgamation, what we talk is the broader process, but this process is generally applied when the group has many companies and they want to get rid of many of them or consolidate to take advantage of the assets lying under them. So when we are talking about a merger of any company, then we have to take care of various laws, which are like Companies Act, Income Tax, RBI law, FEMA if applicable, then accounting standards prescribed by the Government of India. The stamp laws of various states, sometimes competition law is also applicable, then industry specific laws are there. If the company, any of the company involved is a listed entity, then SEBI law also come into picture. So SEBI LODR regulation is the primary law, and there is a circular of SEBI issued on 10th March 2017. So this is very critical to use. So if you are talking about merger or restructuring of group, certain laws which have implications in the process, the first one is the company law. So we have to comply with the provisions of section 230 to 232 of the Companies Act, and in case it is a wholly owned subsidiary consolidation, then there is a special law which is called 233 or fast track merger. So there the process becomes a bit easier. Besides that, there is a rule, companies in compromise arrangement and amalgamation rules that has to be followed. Then the approval of and National Company Law Tribunal would be applicable. And in case it is a fast track merger under section 232, then RD, Regional Director of MCA, will be the approving authority. We have to obtain no objection from the various regulators like ROC, Official Liquidator, Regional Director of MCA, Income Tax Department, and any sectoral regulator, like in case NBFCs are involved, then RBI becomes applicable. Then if it is a listed company, then SEBI is there. Or if it is a broker or any entity, intermediary market, capital market intermediary, then SEBI will be the regulator. So there are no objections and will be applicable. If we talk about the income tax, which is one of the very critical aspects of any restructuring planning, the first thing is, if you are merging various companies or amalgamating, the definition of amalgamation must be fulfilled. The definition of amalgamation is not very complicated. It is simply that the merger should happen on in a normal manner, where there is a equity swap ratio prescribed and no consideration other than equity is given to any person. Maximum consideration in the form of other than equity is given is 25%, which is also need to be justified. Then another, if that is fulfilled, then there are exemptions under section 47 of the Income Tax Act, which basically exempts the shareholders as well as the company from the applicability of capital gain. In case there are accumulated losses in the companies which are getting amalgamated and we want to carry them to the amalgamating company, then amalgamated company, then we need to fulfill the conditions of 72A of the Income Tax Act. So if all these conditions are getting fulfilled, then the amalgamation or consolidation becomes a tax neutral transaction. When we are talking about the consolidation, there is accounting its accounting treatment is also very important. And if the company is a listed company or big size company where Indian accounting standard newly notified Indian accounting standard is applicable, the accounting standard will be 103, which talks about business combinations. If it is not applicable, then the old accounting standard 14 will be applicable. So there are two methods of consolidation. One is the purchase method, where the assets and liability can be taken over on a fair value, and the difference between the assets and liability acquired and the consideration being paid is treated as goodwill or capital reserve, as the case may be. But in case it is a within the group consolidation, mostly it is a controlled transaction. And if it is a controlled transaction, then pooling of interest method will be applicable, where all the assets and liability will be consolidated on line to line basis. Then where it is a listed company involved, then the SEBI has notified the regulation requirement that we have to seek prior no objection of stock exchange and SEBI before even we go to NCLT, National Company Law Tribunal. So generally all the regulators give their comment or observation or no objection at the later stage of any consolidation, but the SEBI and stock exchange have taken over the requirement as a prior approval. So unless SEBI and stock exchange give their no objection, we cannot move to NCLT. Right? So that all the conditions of SEBI circular need to be fulfilled. And if that is happening, then they will give their no objection, and then we can move to NCLT. Another critical aspect while planning for any consolidation is stamp duty liability arising out of the consolidation. So stamp duty is primarily a state subject, and different states have different laws with respect to duty on merger amalgamation. There are many states who have prescribed specific rate of duty. Like in Haryana, there is a specific rate of duty of 1.5% on the value of rural property. But there are other states which have not prescribed any law. Like in Delhi, there is no specific law. However, there are certain landmark judgments like Delhi Towers judgment in Delhi, which determine the rate of duty and applicability of the stamp duty on the base. Now, another important aspect, I think, is valuation aspects. So if we are talking about any scheme of arrangement or consolidation within the group, valuation is very critical. And valuation, as per the new law, as per the Companies Act, and the registered valuer rules have been notified. And any scheme of amalgamation valuation has to be by a registered valuer who is registered with the IBBI, that is Institute of Insolvency and Bankruptcy Board of India. So if that person is registered with that institution, then he will be eligible to value the companies for the purpose of determining the swap ratio. So if all these aspects are taken care of, and as Maluji has already told that the indirect tax is not very critical aspect here, because as soon as we fulfill the definition of amalgamation, or the undertaking is going as a going concern, then transaction is totally exempt under GST law. There will be no GST liability. So indirect tax liability is not a very big concern. I have tried to explain various aspects, regulatory aspect of any consolidation. Now, what are the benefits? So when companies are amalgamated, then there will be these are general benefits like economies of scale. Many companies are getting consolidated, so you will reduce the cost, the size of the business will increase, so network will increase, and it will be easier to manage the affairs, and the overheads will be reduced. So you will get benefit of economies of scale. Then if there is a horizontal or vertical consolidation, the synergy benefits will also arise. Then there may be certain tax shields, tax benefits which you can take, like carry forward of losses. One company is profit earning and another is loss making. Proper planning can be done so that the losses of the company can be carried forwarded. and adjusted for the future benefits. There are, if you are talking about the carry forward losses or consolidation or tax benefits, we have to understand that past losses can be carried forward only in case of industrial companies. So if the companies are not industrial companies which are getting consolidated, then it is better to keep the company which is loss making as a continuing company. And through this scheme, we can have various kind of benefits, like we can swap the name, we can add the object of getting merged into the continuing company. Then consolidated basis, the management can have a focused approach, and they can work in more focused manner on certain limited number of entities, and that will also help them to work for growth and expansion. Always, in most of the cases, if the consolidation is done properly, there will be value enhancement for all the entities. The assets which are underutilized or non-utilized or trapped somewhere in non-working companies will get unlocked, and that benefit can go to the functional company or benefit for the benefit of all stakeholders. So these are the major benefits for which amalgamations are considered. We have seen many big groups in India which have considered consolidation or leaning out as a good approach in the recent past, because of the various reasons, as Pawan sir has already explained in detail. Some of the examples are Minda Group have consolidated many companies, more than 8-9 companies in one or two steps. Then Zydus has also, Cadila Group has also consolidated many of the companies. HCL have many companies which have consolidated. Aurobindo Pharma has done recently. The objects of many of these consolidation may be different, but ultimately they want to unlock the value of the hidden asset. They want to simplify the structure. Multi layers are there in the group, so they want to reduce the layer so that disclosure for the regulatory purpose is easier. All those are the prime objectives, and for that they have done. These are few of the listed entities which I have mentioned here, but there are hundreds of unlisted companies which are also doing it. We are also doing in several cases where 30-35 companies are getting consolidated. Yes, we are facing a few challenges, and we are trying to address those challenges, regulatory as well as procedural aspects. And it will, everyone, management is thinking that it will add value. So I think my presentation, I have tried to keep it short, and my presentation is over. So I think we can have a question answer to give better perspective of all this. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you, Manoj. Thank you very much for giving lucid presentation and giving that what we have to think and what we have to do. I have received various questions, so I think whatever things are there, I will ask you, and accordingly you can both the people can give answer. My first question is, what is the major difference between striking off and voluntary liquidation? How to choose between striking off and voluntary liquidation?
I think the basic difference is, striking off is the process where the registrar of company close the company by a regulatory process where there is no involvement of shareholders majorly. But the main thing is, it can be applied only when there is no share, no assets or liability. That means all the capital in the company has already wiped out through losses, or if something minor amount is left as cash in the books, that can be used, and then company becomes eligible for a strike over. Voluntary liquidation is the voluntary process where the shareholder decides to close a company when it has no purpose left, and they want to distribute the assets lying there. So this happens through the insolvency and bankruptcy law now.
Okay, recently we have new companies binding up rules 2020. Please share your thought on this same.
This voluntary winding up process was section was already there in the company. And due to when the IBC law came, insolvency and bankruptcy code came, the government has decided to withhold that section and when under new companies act, and it was only done through the insolvency and bankruptcy court. Now here, in case of insolvency and bankruptcy court, the precondition is the company should be solvent, then only you can go for voluntary winding up. If it is not solvent, then this process, the IBC process, cannot be applied, and hence here we can use the new provision of company law for voluntary liquidation.
Okay, Manoj, there is another question: is carry forward, whether carry forward of losses is possible or not possible in case of amalgamation of group companies?
Sorry,
whether carry forward of losses is possible or not possible in case of amalgamation of group, when you are merging two group companies, so carry forward loss in one company and profit in another company, can I carry forward the losses in another company also?
Yes, sir. So, for carrying forward any past losses or unabsorbed depreciation, the provisions of Section 72A of the Income Tax Act is applicable. It is available only when there is the company is an industrial company or falling under the definitions of the industrial company as per Section 72A of the Company Income Tax Act. If the conditions are getting fulfilled, yes, then you can certainly carry forward the losses of under the scheme of amalgamation.
Okay, Mr. Malu, can you just tell me that in case you have various companies and you have to restructure, so what is the basic condition? Because when you merge, there are some assets in the company, there are some other business in the company. When you are merging in the company, the stamp duty aspects will be there. There will be some cost aspect will be there. So you may save future costs, but you have to incur a capital a cash cost today. So what is your view when you are taking a call of restructuring, when you have to pay upfront and you have to take benefit in future?
See, first of all, we will see that what businesses we are carrying on, what sorts of resources we are deploying on these things, whether we are having different company secretaries, whether these businesses are having any sort of a synergy. If yes, what is the quantum of the stamp duty involved therein? What is the quantum of MAT carried forward? I just in one of the case we found that in few of the companies we were having MAT carry forward. These companies are the investment companies, and we saw that now the tax on dividend is applicable by the recipient, so that MAT can be used. So we chosen it is better to merge these companies. So it depends on what sort of a business we are and what are the overheads we are carrying on, whether really we need it. I just tell you what we were thinking before COVID-19 and what we are thinking today in COVID-19. Even if we are thinking that there may be some cost involved to this, it is better from compliance point of view, from saving the management bandwidth, we will go for merger of these companies. It's a difficult time. We have to see the cash flow is conserved, the rating of the company is strengthened, the investors are happy, and we are able to sustain in this scenario. So this is my advice to all, and on this basis we generally take the decisions.
Okay, Manoj, when we amalgamate or merge any companies, then we have a asset. Okay, but what are the intangible which you are calculating as a profit? Like, for example, you have incurred some cost like authorized capital, so authorized capital can be merged. You have a carry forward loss, you have a MAT benefit. So what are the total asset which is intangible? So can you name it?
So practically, as you have already told, the most important is the carry forward losses, if there is any, or an unabsorbed depreciation, that should be carried forward. It has good value. Another aspect, as Mr. Malu has just told, that if there is a MAT credit available in any company and it can be carried to another company, then that can be a big benefit. Then the law has clearly said, now Companies Act has provided, that the authorized capital, fee relating to authorized capital or stamp duty relating to stamp capital, authorized capital, as already paid would be consolidated and benefit will be available to the amalgamated company. Similarly, if there are any licenses, approvals, everything, so amalgamation always happens on a going concern basis, and regulators generally allow all the licenses and approvals to carry to the new company. So in the brand or any other benefits, whichever is available, will be transferred. So it will depend upon the case to case, but yes, all the benefit is because it is a going concern basis amalgamation, so everything will get consolidated.
Okay, Manoj, whether section 79 of Income Tax Act is applicable in case of merger, in case of private limited company, merger of private limited company, also in stamp duty level on transfer of 99 years leasehold land?
Yeah, so yes, 79 is applicable only in case of closely held company. If it is a company listed on recognized stock exchange, then 79 is not applicable. Yes, we have to understand that.
Okay, and stamp duty payable for transfer of 99 years leasehold land?
If any property which is in your book for a long term on long term lease basis, like 99 years lease basis, it will be in your book as your property, and you have to get it registered and stamped. So depending upon the state law where it is situated, you have to pay the stamp.
Okay, I think
you want to add something. Yeah.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
In the matter of stamp duty, I would like to add one thing, that one has to go through carefully the law. Even in case of Gujarat, there is an anomaly. What they say is that even the value of plant and machinery is also included, is also considered by way of adding an explanation to the value of immovable property. Although it is challenged in the High Court, and High Court has given a stay, and from none of the companies they have been able to recover it. But it definitely increases the process of creation of the charges. So these sort of aspects should also be taken care of.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. Manoj, one private limited company is converted into LLP. Whether immovable property would attract stamp duty, particularly in Maharashtra?
Conversion of LLP into company we are talking about, right? Maharashtra, yes.
Company to LLP. Yeah.
State. It is a yes. Generally, you can take the benefit of remission of duty, but because stamp duty is a very subjective thing, and that it depends upon the SDM who is handling the matter, you have to give proper representation. It is not amalgamation. It is conversion, and conversion is as per the law. It is a continuation of the company or benefit company. So you can seek the exemption by making an application for remission of liability.
Okay, Manoj, can we consolidate our LLC and company through scheme of arrangement?
Practically not, because LLP law has a specific law with respect to amalgamation of two or more LLPs. Similarly, Companies Act 2013 has a specific provision with respect to amalgamation of companies within the meaning of Companies Act. So earlier, the provision was not the Companies Act. Old Companies Act 1956 has the provision. Any body corporate which is eligible to be wound up under the company law can be merged, amalgamated under the Companies Act. But that provision has now gone, and the NCLT has approved the merger of one LLP into company, but that was challenged and later struck down. So presently, no, it is not possible.
So for this, government has to bring out the new law as they were doing earlier in the old Companies Act.
Yes.
Like they were doing body corporate, so partnership firms are also allowed to merge.
Right.
Okay. What is your thought of merging of LLP formed earlier only to avoid provision of deemed dividend under Section 222E of the Income Tax Act?
Merging of LLP again.
Yeah, merging of LLPs formed earlier only to avoid provision of deemed dividend.
One or more LLPs can be consolidated, but as I just told, that company LLP cannot be merged into company, so it is not possible presently. Regulatory view, MCA view is that you should first convert the LLP into company, and at that time, because it is if it is a size big, 60 lakh or more is the turnover and the assets involved, then you have to pay capital gain at the time of conversion itself. So later on you can come consolidate. So benefit can be taken later on.
Okay, Manoj, now I have so many companies in the group, and some companies have outside shareholders. Now, if I am going to the route of NCLT, it is taking too much time, okay, because other shareholder can create problems or some other reason. Can I do fast track? What is the solution for this?
So, Section 233 of the Companies Act, which is a new provision for fast track merger, it requires approval from regional director in place of MCA, Ministry of NCLT. But the provision is very clear that you need approval from 90% of the shareholders in value as well as in number term. So if you can gather that much, then you can, and you are fulfilling the condition that it is a merger between two small companies, because it is not a wholly owned subsidiary case. As you are already saying, there are public shareholders. So if it is there, you are fulfilling the definition of a small company, and you can gather no objection from 90% of the total shareholders and shareholder creditors. Then you can go for fast track merger. Otherwise, NCLT is the only route. But practically, I am saying that now NCLT, because insolvency law has gone from for suspended for certain period, 1 year or more, NCLT would also do fast track in the process, merger process. The ministry is also considering specific benches for merger process.
Achha, Manoj, we are a listed company. We own two LLPs with same ownership ratio, same partners. What is the best option, merger or to achieve leading out?
As I told NC,
will it be better to cannot
be, presently LLP cannot be merged into a company, so you have to convert those LLPs into company if you want to merge. Now you have to see whether this is tax efficient or not. Conversion is tax efficient or not, because under the tax law, conversion is a taxable event. There is exemption if it is a small size LLPs with less than 60 lakh rupees of turnover and asset size, then only it is exempt. In all other cases, it is taxable event.
Okay, there's a big question. To avail the benefit of fast track merger, if the transferee company within the same group wants to purchase shares of all the shareholders of transferor company through execution of SPA, and 2-3 shareholders are dissenting from selling of the shares, how can share be purchased to make the transferor company wholly owned subsidiary of transferor fee company prior to fast track merger?
Under the present law, there is no provision of squeezing out any public shareholder. You cannot force anyone to sell their share if they don't want to. So there is no such option. Yes, if you are eligible, so why it is better to go for NCLT route, and you can under NCLT route, the provision is that only 10% or more shareholder can object to any scheme of amalgamation. Otherwise, they don't have any locus.
Okay. Manoj, is it mandatory to file revised return after approval of a scheme which was presented for lean out?
No, under income tax does not require mandatorily to revise. Some benefit, you can revise the return, or at the time of scrutiny, if there is any, department may say to consolidate and revise the return. But otherwise, it is not required. I think Manoj want to add something.
Yes, I just had to add a supplementary thing to the Manoj, that it's not required, but if really there is some benefit, say section 32 AD, some depreciation benefit is there, some carry forward of the MAT is there, or unabsorbed leverage is there, then you have to file manually a revised return at the time of assessment, and then you have to get the benefit. That's my practical experience.
Okay, Maluji, tell me, when you are a listed company and you have a big board also, when you are planning to restructure group and going to the board, what are the main issues board is considering and board is asking?
See, the major issue board is considering for merger, or whether it is for demerger, it may be both way, but basically they are asking about that what are the basic reasons and what is the thought process of the management, what sort of a benefit, cost benefit it is giving. So we are giving, we first of all, we are doing a techno feasibility study. We are having consultant internal discussions with the management teams. We are discussing with the consultants, and a full-fledged presentation is given to the board about these parts. Maybe in the first go they may agree or they may not agree. Then you know we give it, and then considering all these aspects, we got the approval.
Okay. Whether a voluntary liquidation asset can be distributed to shareholders?
Yes, if the shareholders resolve to distribute the assets in a piecemeal manner in place of liquidating them, and the liquidator feels that it is logical to distribute the assets as such, and there is no creditor to pay, or there are sufficient cash to pay the creditors, if any, then you can go for distribution of it.
Okay, can we merge two LLP, one LLP with another LLP?
Yes, that is specifically allowed.
So we have to go to NCLT, or we have to go to the
yes, NCLT is the forum.
Acha, what is the procedure to amalgamate investment companies?
Investment companies are also a normal company. Only thing is, if it is falling under BFC, then RBI approval would be required. And RBI generally see that if there is a change in control or not. If that is the case, then they ask for new management approval for new management. Or if there is any other major structural change, any one person is person's holding is increasing beyond by 26% or more, then they need a specific approval KYC of that person. They will give no objection for that. If it is not, then KYC, so we are core investment company of the group. Then it can be merged without approval of RBI, but you have to see that it does not breach the condition of systemically important and core investment company, which is 100 crore presently in its own fund.
Maluji, if you have various company in your group and one company is creating a problem because of some regulatory approval, what you will do as a CFO of a company, as a planner of the company? Whether you will try to merge this or you want to sell it in the market, what is the best way you have to do?
Sir, specifically, I will not reply it with reference to my company, but I can reply you in general.
Yeah, general. I am asking general question.
Yes, general question. That, you know, we have to see various perspectives. That, after all, what is the valuation we are getting? Sell, buy and sell is a different valuation. If buy and sell is there, then what sort of a case consideration you are receiving in any company? Whether do you really need that sort of a case? Whether there are the debt above the neck or above the head? What sort of interest rates you are paying? And suppose, is there any investor readily available? What is your promoter's holding? Is it a sustainable partner? All these aspects we are considering before deciding that whether to sell any of the business, buy this business, or to do a demerger, this sort of exercise.
Okay. Well, in case of striking of Section 14, realizing of remaining cash by the shareholder after striking off will attract DDT.
Sorry, sir, voice was not clear. Hello.
In case of striking off under Section 248, realization of remaining cash by the shareholders after striking off will attract DDT, dividend distribution tax.
As I told you clearly, striking off under 242 is applicable only when there is no cash left in the, no asset left in the company. So if there is a cash, you have to first distribute it, or in the form of dividend, or there is some expense, you have to pay that off so that there is no money left in the company. And then only you can apply to ROC for a strength. So otherwise, you have to go for voluntary funding process, fund liquidation process.
Okay. So basically, it is through dividend tax is to be paid practically.
If there is a profit accumulated, you have to pay dividend.
Yes.
Okay. Is amalgamation of two LLPs a tax neutral? No capital gain?
A specific provision is not there, yes, but generally you can say it is a by operation of law, and then 47 you may apply, but not generally.
Okay, company ID having only cash in hand with no assets. Now in voluntary world liquidation, how the distribution will be made and tax implication?
So it is a fit case for voluntary liquidation, and if we are going for voluntary liquidation, then to the extent of accumulated profit, it will be as deemed, it will be deemed dividend, and as per the new law, dividend is distributable in the hand of the individual shareholders. So so whatever the amount is available in the company, to the extent it is relating to the value of the company's share, it will remain like the paid up capital plus free reserve. It will be in the hand tax free in the hands of the shareholder. And if they have bought it at a lower price than the book value per share, then they will have to pay capital gain. And to the extent of accumulated profit, distributable profit, they have to pay dividend distribution tax under as another source of it. This is other income.
Okay, Manoj, now 15 minutes are and we have various questions, so I will start rapid round. Okay, so in the rapid round, you have to give answer in a very short, because I have to cover all the questions. Whether tax dispute of group companies will be hurdle in consolidation of companies?
It should not be, because the liability should continue. But yes, income tax department may put some objection, and you have to give undertaking that consolidated entity will pay all the liabilities.
If the dispute in the transferor company, then
still you can do. You have to take the give the undertaking that whatever result of that dispute, you have to pay the liability.
Okay, can we claim benefit of Section 72A during consolidation of group companies in all cases?
Sorry,
can we claim benefit of Section 72 during consolidation? Group companies in all cases?
Yes, we can claim. Only the condition is that we have to continue. We have to continue for 5 years. The business, okay. We have to continue for 5 years.
Okay.
Claiming is not an issue.
Okay. Can benefit under 72A of income tax be denied even though the condition are getting fulfilled?
Generally not.
Okay. Can MAT credit be transferred to transferee company through the scheme? There is no specific law.
Yes, there is no specific law. Still, it is allowed. Nobody is object to it.
Manuji, you have any different view?
Yes, no different view. In fact, in the scheme of amalgamation, we are mentioning this, that MAT will be carried forward, balances in the GST and etc. will be carried forward, electricity security deposit will be carried forward. So we are covering it, and based on the NOCs which we are obtaining from the income tax department, there are no issues in adjusting the and carry forwarding made in the transferring company.
Right. Okay. Income tax does not object to this part of the scheme.
Okay. What is the role of GAR in case of scheme of merger and demerger?
So it is a new law. The law is very clear. It can be applied only when the transaction is completed, when the action income tax department, while scheme at a later date, finds that it was a sham scheme only just made to avoid tax, and then they may and subject to threshold as prescribed under the GAR, they may invoke that. But generally, it is not applicable during the merger process.
Okay, company has not filed account for 2 years, has no business with some cash in hand with no asset. Now the management wants to exit. What is the route available?
Management want to exit, so it is not carrying any business. So it may be a fit case for striking off of the company. Otherwise, yes, they may sell if there is some asset and which has some value. Someone may be interested to buy the company. Buy the company out.
You have a cash in the company, not asset.
Then voluntary liquidation may be a process, suitable process, but you have to be there will be tax liability.
Okay, Manoj, there is a listed company, there is no trading, okay, and the shareholders are very old, and I want to merge this company in our group company because there is no trading. what is the best route available for us?
Reverse merger in case of listed company is always difficult task. Listed company generally should be kept as the continuing company, and all and the business company should be merged, because SEBI generally does not allow merger of unlisted listed company into unlisted company. Alternatively, there is a specific provision we have to seek exemption from SEBI under rule 19(2)(b) of SCRR for listing of the newly listed company. There are conditions that the post merger scenario, the listed company's 25% shareholder should continue to be the shareholder. At least 25% of the post merger capital should be with the public shareholder of listed company. If that condition is getting fulfilled, then reverse merger may be allowed.
Okay, in case of consolidation of group companies, if 45% shareholder of the group companies are not traceable, then how can we give the consolidation in our flagship company?
How many percent is there, sir?
4 to 5%.
Law is very clear. For any merger, you need approval of 90%. In case you want to exemption from the shareholders meeting and creditors meeting, you need 90% of the shareholder in value term, creditors in value term, 90% consent in the form of affidavit. So 4% is not a problem. Otherwise, alternatively, you may call the shareholders meeting, and there it will be the resolution need to be approved by 3/4 in value of the present and voting. Simple majority of persons present in voting, so that would also be, I think, sufficient. So both the methods are available.
Okay, is it necessary that the valuation date of a scheme of merger should be the same as the appointed date?
No, it is not. Valuation is always on a later date, and it cannot be on the appointed date. Appointed date is the technical date from which assets and liability or business is transferred when a scheme is approved. But the valuation always happened at a later date when the balance sheet of the appointed date is available, and whenever the valuer do the valuation, valuers do the valuation, they take the latest financials to determine the consideration or swap ratio. So it is not necessary. Yes, in one case, NCLT Mumbai has given such judgment that both dates should be coinciding, but it is not a normal precedent.
Okay, very interesting case. In case of consolidation of closely held group company, where entire shareholding of each of the company involved are held by members of the same family, the company decided not to appoint any registered valuer, but decided the share exchange ratio mutually. What is your view? Is it registered valuer is appointed as compulsory, or my own valuation is okay?
If we talk about the practicality, NCLT would like to have a fair valuation, and other regulators would also ask for that. But legally, it says that if there is a valuation, it has to be by the registered value. If there is no valuation, there is no question of registered value. So it depends upon the situation. But practically, yes, all the regulators ask for the valuation report. So it is better to have the valuation report to avoid.
In case of fast track merger under section 233, whether application need to be made to all the RDs involved, or if the companies fall under the jurisdiction of different RD?
No, final approval will be given by the RD of the transferee company, that is the continuing company. All other have nothing to give, no objection to be given. But generally the approving RD takes their view in consideration, and hence the copy is served on them also.
Okay, can consideration of merger by way of gift instead of cash within the group companies, both of which are private companies in place, can we do this?
Merger in the consideration in the form of cash.
Can consideration of merger by way of gift instead of cash within the group companies, both which are privately held companies?
Consideration cannot be a gift. A company cannot give gift. It is a swap of share. Generally, the merger, to fulfill the definition of amalgamation under income tax, we have to give consideration in the form of equity or other shares, which is convertible into equity. Then only it will fulfill the definition. Yes, to the tax law itself provides up to 25%, maybe in the form of cash or other consideration. So that is possible, but the gift, I don't think how to address this.
We see the income tax act section 56, then any gift above 50,000 will be taxable. So yeah. I think practically no one would like to do the gifting from one company to another company.
Yeah.
Another supplement to the earlier question is that one person is having surplus case, one company is having surplus case and want to distribute it, whether there will be dividend distribution tax in all the cases. So my submission is I would like to see that who needs the case, whether in that group the case is required for doing the business or for personal expenses or for buying out some property. So in that case I will suggest, I will suggest that why not to merge this case surplus company to another company who really needs this case, and this way we can really plan the saving of the dividend distribution tax.
Right.
Hello, there's a multiple question. Our registered office of all the companies are situated in Delhi for factory of other functional unit in Haryana. So we have to pay stamp duty in Delhi as well as Haryana, or we should shift the office at Haryana?
Yes. Law is very clear. In Delhi, it is based on the judgment of Delhi Towers, where the duty is to be payable on the basis of the consideration being paid. So if the registered office is in Delhi, the consideration would be assumed to be paid in Delhi, and you have to pay 3% stamp duty on the value of the consideration paid. Whereas further, the involved property or factory is in Haryana, so the law is, their law is specifically providing 1.5% of the value of the involved property would be stamp duty liability in Haryana. So if we shift the registered office of all the companies in Haryana, then you can save that consideration based duty, emerald property based duty will be applicable.
But it will take time because we have to first shift all the company, 4-5 months process, then doing this.
Yes. If you want to save that, that is the cost benefit analysis you have to do, time and cost benefit analysis.
That may be a timely planning, maybe a time period of 3 months around.
Okay. Right. Okay, tell me, so any planning of stamp duty can you suggest, because stamp duty is a main hurdle for leaning out. So what is the best way to plan stamp duty?
I think with respect to stamp duty, yes, it is the biggest cost involved, immediate cost involved in any cash outflow involved. So yes, you have to see which jurisdiction has the least tax liability, and if you can shift the registered office there to avoid the consideration based duty. But involved property based duty you cannot avoid. Then for that purpose you should see which of the entities should be kept as a continuing company. The company which has the largest asset should be as a continuing company, and all other smaller companies should be merged there. If you have a specific requirement with respect to name or some brand related thing, you can swap those name as part of the scheme, so that is not a challenge. So yes, this is the planning, but you have to see each state where the factory or business location are there or asset is there, and also the registered office, and then based on that planning has to be.
Manoj, can you suggest something? Yeah, Manoji, you are saying.
Manoj, you know, in different states there are concessional duties and there is a gap, yes, also. So right. I do not particularly find that if there is a need and really a restructuring is required, a consolidation is required, stamp duty otherwise also is a one-time cost, and there are various layouts to it. We should at least sit on the table, we should plan it out, and when you will, I just guarantee you, sir, Pawanji, that when you plan in consolidation and when you execute it, there is a double saving of what you have planned.
Right.
Okay.
We
okay.
generally don't mind, you know, the management cost, the management bandwidth. You are filing so many GST returns, you are filing so many cases, so many persons are involved. And you know, in particular time of COVID-19, where you have to put the habit of work from home, etc., it is very important that the time is required on the important assignments.
But Mr. Malu, the point is that...
Rightly said that...
Pardon?
The promoter is asking that what is the outflow? An outflow is immediately and return is in future. So that is a main hurdle. So you have to provide all expenditure, all direct or indirect benefit, and then you can convince promoter that they should consolidate. Otherwise, these cost aspects are all hindering. Yeah.
Yes. Yes. I agree with you. And we have to sit on the table. We have to plan it out. We have to work it out. We have to say ROI of that. And in most of the cases, you will find that it is justifiable. Okay. There are indirect benefits, improvement in your rating, dealing and negotiation with your banks. There are a lot of instruments which you can go through with the size of the company. You can't otherwise go. So it is not right. Only the main cost. There is a substantial savings in the interest also.
Okay, last few questions, Manoj. What is the meaning of consideration for stamp duty purpose? Whether it is a bank book value of market value of the shares of the transferor company?
So, as I said earlier, it is a state subject. Generally, it is written that you have to pay the duty on the basis of the fair value of the shares being issued. Fair value is sometimes defined, in most of the time it is not defined. So either it will be the fair value as on the appointed date or as prescribed under the scheme of amalgamation, that is the valuation report, that will be the consideration. That will be the determining factor.
Generally, in case of listed companies, it is the traded price, the closing hour price of the on the stock exchange that is applicable on the appointed date, right?
Okay, Manoj, is stamp duty payable on immovable property held by 100% subsidiary on its merger with holding company?
That is again a question, a disputable question. Yes, generally it is payable, and that is paid based on the shares value of shares getting cancelled under the scheme. However, in a state where there is an old exemption available, like in Uttar Pradesh, there is a 1942 surplus, any amalgamation of 90% or more subsidiary with the holding. Similarly, there was an old circular of 1937 in Delhi, which exempted stamp duty in case of merger of 90% or more subsidiary. But there is a confusion from 1937 in 2001 is by chance not withdrawn. Dispute. Several cases are pending before various courts, various adjudicating authorities.
I am also experienced that in case of Rajasthan, the stamp duty is paid on the net consideration, that is the value of the sales which you are issuing.
Okay. Manoj, last few questions, then we have to close it. As stated above, cash in hand is less than 2 lakh. Whether it will be a feasible for valuation to strike 2 is more, I think this question is incomplete. There is a company partner in 4 partnership firm. The company is held by 2 family in equal proportion of 50% each. They want to now separate the business, but with the condition that each of the family get 50% holding in the partnership firm, which is presently held by company. What would be the most efficient way to do the settlement? How to divide these companies?
If they are partners and not relatives, then it is a complicated situation. If they are partners or relative, then first we can consider demerger of the company into 2 parts and then swap of share among the persons who are exempt under income tax law. But if they are partners not related to each other, then this process is also not feasible. So then family settlement, business settlement, whatever the tax liability will be there, you have to pay at the time of transfer.
Last 2 questions. SEBI stands that any scheme of merger, demerger, the post scheme holding of promoter on fully diluted basis should not be 75%. But in case of group companies, consolidation shares will be issued to promoters only, and our 75% limit will be breached. How we can overcome this kind of situation?
Presently, there is no clear-cut solution to this. The SEBI has people used to give a convertible instrument in place of equity, but they have put in now the condition of fully consideration of 25% on fully diluted basis. So it is a difficult proposition right now. If your holding is going beyond, then you have to give maybe you can give redeemable preference shares as a consideration, or certain parts maybe. Before that, you can plan by acquiring certain shares which can get cancelled in the merger process. So those planning, but that has to be tax efficient. It needs a lot of planning.
Okay. Manoj, I think second last question. In case there is a merger of multi-layer companies where an upper layer companies are being collapsed into the lower level company, no share would be issued in one and two layer companies, the one and two layer mergers. And only ultimate beneficiary would get shares in the lowest layer surviving company, whether it is a compliance with the definition of amalgamation. So you have one layer, then second, third, and fourth. So second and third is collapsing, and one and fourth is remaining. So what is the?
So amalgamation, the definition of amalgamation requires that at least 75% of the shareholders of a company other than the company holding the share itself should continue to be the shareholder of amalgamation. So practically we have to do the amalgamation in a step manner, and first we have to collapse the upper company into first layer company, then second layer company, then third layer company. Though it can be through one scheme only, but we have to write in a manner that first layer is giving shares to another upper layer, then it is getting collapsed and again shares are getting cancelled and issued. So that has to be factored in the scheme itself. Yes, it has a different challenge. In the stamp duty department may also ask for every layer's stamp duty separately, but many such cases have already happened.
Okay, Manoj, because there are so many real estate companies, they are a multiple 100 company, 200 companies. How you will restructure these real estate company? So what suggestion you will give to them and how they should restructure?
In real estate industry, mainly the companies were formed mainly to avoid the land ceiling provisions. So the restrictions were there. So they used to acquire share property land in different entities. And after the project is approved, and it is coming out of the village area, it becomes commercial or is residential. Then they consolidate the assets through development right agreement or something like that. So if that is already there and consideration is already passed on and the entity is practically empty, only ownership of the land is in their book, then consolidation can be done and consideration need not be paid because consideration was already done. So I think that can be done and there will be no major tax liability.
Okay, for all these types of restructuring or leaning out, we require valuation compulsorily, or we can do valuation on the basis of settlement price?
Valuation report is generally recommended. If there is a valuation, it has to be by the registered valuer. So if word is there, but practically all the regulator asks for the valuation report. Yes, after the valuation is arrived and board may consider a different consideration. That is also a well-settled position. Valuer only gives the valuation opinion, and it may or may not be accepted fully by the board of directors of each of the company. So they may negotiate a price higher or lower than that, and it may be accepted.
Okay, Manoj, I think we have given all the answers which we have received. Friends, anybody's answer is anybody's question is not answered, you just send it to us again, and we will give you separately if answer is missing. So friends, thank you very much. We have tried to give, I think we have received more than 60 questions. We have some but the duplicate, and we have merged these questions. So we have tried to give the answer of all the questions. So thank you very much. This leaning out of group, we have created a product where you can think of that anybody wants to leaning out. It's a consolidated work of tax, companies and company law, and then valuation, and then listing, RBI, regional director, various approval, income tax, CCI if it is required. It's a consolidated work. So the corporate professional has come out with leaning out of the group. there is a one complete restructuring package that how we can help you. So anybody wants to understand this particular aspects, and future belongs to leaning out, simplified, and the efficient structure. So with this thing, I again thanks everybody who has participated, who has attended the program, and the next program we will organize and shortly will inform all the participants. Thanks for giving us this showering our the things that corporate professional program are coming. So thank you very much, Mr. Malu, Preeti Malhotra, and Manoj for participating, and thanks all delegate, those who have participated and those who have patiently listened to this. Thank you very much, friends. Thank you.
Thank you very much.